trespasses and sins. Wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all live as they all. We all had our conversation in time past, the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, but God was rich in mercy for his great love, wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ, by grace we are saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who were called uncircumcision, by that which is called the circumcision, in the flesh made by hands, that at the time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes were far off, are made nigh by the blood of Jesus. May the Lord just bless me upon his word. May it be sanctified in our hearts. May we see it. I want to speak to you from the subject of God is loaded. God is loaded. My nephew, Jonathan, made an interesting statement. When he was probably about 10 years old, he recognized something. That Jonathan is the second born of four children, and he's the only boy that my sister, Ollie, Harold has. And Jonathan recognized that his younger sister, Ashley, was brilliant. And she is brilliant. And Jonathan recognized that. And Jonathan recognized that Ashley always seemed to have money. She has this knack of managing her money well. She doesn't spend it. She don't run to the mall with her money. Jonathan recognized that. He recognized whenever he needed a loan, Ashley had it. Jonathan said, I'm going to be good to Ashley, but she will be rich. Jonathan said that she was going to be loaded. And so believing that Ashley would someday be wealthy, he was trying to ensure his own financial future by being nice to his younger sister at the time. She was about 8, and he was, I think, almost 10. And he was going to be nice to her because one day, she was going to be loaded. We have a tendency in the world in which we live, even the best of us find ourselves showing partiality toward people who have means. Even the Bible warns us against that. It warns us don't show partiality toward people just because they have position or power or influence or clout. And we should treat everyone with dignity and respect. But money has a way of getting our attention. It gets the best of our attention. And we get very open, emotional over money. I mean, we can get right mean when we mess with our dreams. We can get funny when we play with our money. Tony Brown always said, I've told you before, that money is not the most important thing in the world. He says about ranking right up from oxygen. Y'all a little slow this morning. But money is an important commodity in the society in which we live. But it is not the most important thing. Our relationships are more important than money. Amen. And the relationship we have with God is the most important commodity in all the world. I think that what Paul was talking about this in his text. Maybe not his main idea, but definitely in movement of promises and bonuses. So I'm going to confess it right here. And it was about, and Bruce Willis was playing the movie, and I think the title of the movie was The Sixth Sense. And in this movie, this little boy, he could see dead people. And no one else could see these dead people. Bruce Willis was playing a psychologist, a psychiatrist, I think, some type of doctor of the mind. And this young boy was brought to him, and guess what? Bruce Willis could also see dead people. So together, the two of them could see the dead people, and the dead people always talked to the little boy, and it was all known about them trying to warn someone else, or trying to bring about justice for something that had been done unjustly. And for the life of him, Bruce Willis couldn't figure out what was going on and why only this young boy could see the dead people. Well, he did not know that there was a greater story in this for him. Because the fact that he could see the dead people meant that he himself was dead. And he did not know that he was dead. He thought that he was alive. And he wondered why his wife would not listen to him. He was talking to her and she was basically ignoring him. He did not realize that he really was dead. So what we have in society today is just in that movie, we are walking dead people. We are walking dead people. People are walking and they're eating and they're sleeping and they're engaging in all types of recreational and social activity, but they are spiritually dead. And that's what Paul was saying in Ephesians chapter 1:2, verses 1-3. He describes our state before Christ. He says in verse 1, you have the equipment who were dead in trespasses and sins, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit of now working the children of disobedience. He described the church at Ephesians, he described those believers as being previously dead in trespasses and sins. Oh, they were physically alive, responding to physical stimuli, but they were spiritually dead. And now they come to faith in the living Christ. Paul did not want them to go too quickly beyond verse 8 before they came to Christ. He reminded them that you are what you are, not because of what you've done, but because of the grace of God. You were dead, held hostage by habits and hang-ups and dysfunction. Dead in trespass and sin, when in time past you walk according to the course of this world. So dead people who are dead spiritually are walking consistently with the spirit of this age. How do you watch television lately? It's bizarre what's coming on network television. It's bizarre the things that come right on the screen. I'm talking about during the middle of the day, the afternoon. It's not necessarily the late night, or 8 or sunlight. I'm talking about the regular television, the type of thing that come on TV. It's obvious that there's a spirit that is working in this age. A spirit of promiscuity, a spirit of immorality, a spirit that throws off authority. There's a spirit that is working. And this spirit has many people captivated. They're captivated by the spirit of the age that responds and that it excites, I should say, and it stimulates the flesh and arouses the pleasure senses in our bodies. And so I describe this as being the overstimulated generation. The overstimulated generation, a generation, particularly young people, who have been exposed to too much stimulation too early. And I encourage young people, you just gotta be careful. I'm not some old folk. I'm just trying to tell you what you have to gotta watch out for. You gotta watch out for allowing yourself to be exposed to too much, too fast, before you are emotionally and psychologically prepared to deal with all the ramifications of what the exposure creates inside of you. Are y'all gonna help me? Amen. I was going back home yesterday after the funeral. And I turned the radio on. I couldn't believe it. I just couldn't believe it. The FCC is just asleep. There's no longer a federal cause ministry to proliferate. And they're being exposed to this, and it's shaping their mind in a twisted, in a bent way about the sexuality. Not even
Amen. Amen.
And no one wants to talk about this, but there's tremendous sexual dysfunction in our society today, and it's starting because young people are being exposed too quickly to too much too early. And so the whole view of sex and sexuality becomes perverted before they even have a chance of really understanding what God intended and what God desired for man and woman to experience in the confines of marriage. Y'all are helping me. And we're not exempt from this. And as adults, as Christians, we're not exempt. We're not exempt from having our appetites to go from what is natural to move to what is unnatural. To what becomes perverted. What becomes devilish beside the God. So Paul says to them, remember what you were before you became what you are. Dead in trespass and sin, moving according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, among whom time we have all had our conversation in time past, in the lust of our flesh, and from the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath. But two things he says. Paul says we were the children of disobedience, and we were the children of wrath. And the term children of wrath, it literally means we were the bullseye for God's judgment. In other words, we were a bullseye for the judgment of God to strike us. That is what we were before we came to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And look what Paul does. He also encourages us, don't you forget this. Because I think that Paul, being the type of evangelist that he was, he always wanted to have the church to be on the cutting edge of evangelism. And Paul said, I don't want you to think about these things where you vicariously relive them again. And like the children of Israel, where you're longing to be back in that again. But I want you to understand and remember the grip and the clutches that were in your own life. I want you to remember the way you used to think about these things and how these things dominated your thinking and they controlled your thinking and therefore controlled your behavior. I want you to remember those things because that's the only way that you will stay in tune and in touch with a society that's forgotten God. So he said, remember as a child of disobedience, remember as a child of wrath, remember the lifestyle, remember the conversation before you came to Christ so that you can be effective in reaching out to the gospel. And then in verse 4, verse 3b again, he says, among them also we had our conversation in time past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as others, but God. But God. And sometimes in the church, we forget how sinful sin is. Sometimes in the church, we sing so many songs about grace and about mercy, and we experience so much the love of God and the mercy and the forgiveness of God, we just forget how sinful sin really is and how destructive sin was in our own lives, how destructive sin is in the lives of other people. But God. And somebody here this morning needs to focus on that but God. Because someone here this morning is still held in the grip of sin. Some habit, some hang-up, some dysfunction. Something that just causes you shame and guilt and the sense of just being dirty and being unclean and longing and desire to be delivered from it. I just stopped by the team this morning, but God.
Amen.
But God. God did not save you to abandon you. God did not save you to leave you to be destroyed by those hazards, to be destroyed by those hang-ups. God saved you so that you can show forth the praises of his glory. And so even at your lowest point, you've got to remember, but God. But God still loves me. God is still working in my life. God has promised. He has promised that he which began a good work in me, he will fulfill it into the day of Jesus Christ. But God. But look at what Paul says. He says, but God, who is rich in mercy. And that's where I get my thing from. God is loaded. Paul said, even though our condition, we were spiritually shipwrecked, great love wherewith he loved us. Not only is God rich in mercy, but God also has great love with which he loves us. And even when we were dead in sins, he quickened us together with Christ. By grace are we saved, and raised us up together and made us to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That's a tremendous spiritual transaction, just in those two verses. I mean, we go to being children of disobedience, bullseye for God's judgment, fulfilling the lust of our flesh, the desires of our mind, spiritually bankrupt, destitute, without hope in the world. We experience the mercy and the grace of God, and then we become wealthy. And we become seated with Christ in the heavenly places. In the heavenly places. And so as believers, we got to focus on not only what God did for us in terms of forgiving us of our sins, what Christ did for us in terms of raising us up out of a lifestyle of sin, setting our feet on a solid rock. And the fact in the mind of God, we're already in heaven. We're already there with Christ. So he says, he has raised us up together. He's made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That in the age to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. Let's stop right there. If I was a billionaire, and I'm not. If I was a billionaire, and I'm not. If I was a thousandaire, and I'm not. But if I were a billionaire and if I were to write you a check for $1,000, that's not even dropping the bucket. Out of my wealth. I gave you out of my wealth, but I didn't give you according to my wealth. If I were to write you a check for $1,000,000, now I've given you according to my wealth. God deals with us according to how wealthy he is. According to how wealthy, since God is loaded, watch this. Since God is loaded, he's loaded spiritually. He has spiritual wealth. He has all the wealth of the universe. So God desired us to be saved, and God wants us to be saved so that we can experience all of eternity with him. And experiencing all of eternity with him, we can be recipients of God's wealth and of God's riches. So it would take God all of eternity, which has no end, before he could ever fully share with us his riches. So God saves us so we can spend all eternity with him. And so for all eternity, we can experience his wealth. For all eternity, we experience his mercy, we experience his grace, his love, and his kindness. God didn't just write us a check at salvation and say, look, here's the check, salvation. That's all you get. Don't come back and ask for no more. Salvation is all you get. Don't come back and ask for no more. God, at Calvary, the transaction indeed takes place for the sin debt is indeed paid, and Christ is raised from the dead, and since the sin debt is now paid, God continually bestows upon us according to his riches. Out of his riches, out of his abundant grace, and he takes us to be with him for all eternity so that we can fully appreciate and fully experience all of his great work. Verse 7 again, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace. You know, not only is God loaded, God is a show-off. And you can be a show-off if you're really good at something. You can be a show-off if you're really good at it, if you've mastered your craft, if you've mastered your trade. So God is a master of his craft of salvation, a master of forgiveness, a master of deliverance. He's the master of it all, and so God likes to show it all. He likes to show it all. And the way God best shows off his attributes is dealing with sinners like you. That's the way God shows off his riches. That's the way he shows off his mercy. He shows off his grace by bestowing it upon you and me. And so I'm not saying this to give you a license to think you can go and sin and do what you want to do, because the Bible says, since we're saved from sin, God forbid that we should continue any longer therein. But what I am here to tell you is that the grace of God had already made provision for you before you sin. And so if you do sin, then you do not have to worry. ashamed and disgraced and think that it's all over. If you do sin, you don't have to feel like I've now forfeited my salvation because I was unable to maintain my commitment to God. If you do sin, you have an advocate. Jesus Christ, the righteous one, he's right there at the right hand of the Father. He's already pleaded your case, interceded on your behalf, and he says, Father, that's already taken care of. I've already handled that. My grace and my mercy was sufficient enough not only to save them from the sin they had committed before salvation, but to keep on cleansing them from all unrighteousness after salvation. My God! God is loaded. He is loaded. And so when you feel depressed, and you feel discouraged, and you think you have depleted all the resources of heaven, I'm just not going to tell you, you have not even scratched the surface. God is loaded. And it pleases God, listen to me, it pleases him to respond to the broken spirit, to the contrite heart.
Yes, sir.
Don't you know when you sin and you know you have sinned? And don't you know when you know you have sinned and you go to God, confessing your sin with God, not trying to justify it, rationalize it, explain it away, not saying, well, Lord, I did that because he did this and they did this. When you go there and say, Lord, it's me, oh Lord, stand in me first. Don't you know God delights and opened up his riches out of heaven to deal with that? He's loaded. God is a spiritual philanthropist. He's going to give it all away. He's going to give it all. He's going to give his grace away. He's going to give his mercy away. He gives it away and disperses it upon those who have the greatest need. That's why Jesus got in trouble with the religious leaders of his day, because they weren't used to a holy man dealing with unholy people. They had separated themselves by definition, the Pharisees, the separated ones. And they had separated themselves from the common people, would not intermingle with the whoremongers and the adulterers, would have nothing to do with the lepers. And so they were totally surprised when Jesus kept coming, republicans and sinners. And Jesus' response to them was, they that are whole don't need a physician, but they that are sick, I didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Because God can't show off unless he's dealing with sinners. That's when he shows up. That's when he shows how wealthy he is in spiritual blessings, and how he can change and turn people's lives around.
Yeah.
You won't miss that, be
true.
Verse 7 again, in the age to come, ages to come, ages, ages, eons, eons, ages, eons, eons, eons to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are you saved, through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For by grace are you saved. Have you been saved? Are you being saved? And by grace you ultimately will be saved. Your salvation has three tenses, past tense. When you accepted Jesus Christ, you were saved. You were saved from the penalty of sin. You were saved. When you said, Lord Jesus, come into my life and save me, you were saved from the penalty of sin. There's now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk after the Spirit and not of the flesh. For the life of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus made us free from the law of sin and death. You have been saved from sin. That happened when you received Christ. You are being saved from the practice of sin. As we grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we are being saved from the practice of sin. That's called sanctification. It's called practical sanctification. As we grow in grace and grow in the knowledge of the Word of God, and we come to realize, that's wrong, I shouldn't be doing that. And we confess that the Lord is sin, and God gives us strength to say no to things we used to say yes to. There are some things that we ought to be saying no to today that we said yes to yesterday. Are you trying to have happy this morning? There are some things I ought to be to say by the grace of God, not because of my own will or my own decision of resolve, but by the grace of God, I'm able to say no to some things I used to say yes to. Because the believer who is progressing in sanctification, who is progressing in practical holiness, is sinning less. I didn't say sin less. I said sinning less. Okay? Not sinless, but sinning less. Because the Spirit of God brings things to our hearts and our minds. We repent. We receive and do a get the victory. Amen. So for by grace are you saved, through faith, Amen. And not acceptance. Now, why would he have provided them with it? He told them the children robbed, children disobedient, target of God's bullseye, walking according to lust of the flesh, controlled by the spirit of the age. He's probably written as worse and descriptive of them as possible, but he still comes down and says, for by grace are you saved. And none of yourselves. Because there's always a tendency in the human heart to take credit for that which belongs to another. There's always a tendency in the human heart to want credit for that which belongs to another. And Paul is saying here, not only your salvation, but the very faith that you use to tap into salvation, that's a gift of God. Amen. God gives us the faith to believe. And then faith becomes the channel through which God brings salvation. He says, "For grace are you saved through faith, not of yourself, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Now watch the progression. Children of disobedience, children of wrath, children of walking according to the spirit of the age, dominated by fleshly and lustful passions and desires. But God, experiencing the grace of God. And then in verse 10 says, well, we are his workmanship. Look to your neighbor and say, you're God's workmanship. You're God's workmanship. God's masterpiece. God's masterpiece. When God shows you his salvation, he knew what he was getting. God don't get no pigs and poles. I mean, he knew what he was getting when he chose this. He knew what he was getting when he chose me. He wasn't getting much. But in the eye of God, in the mind of God, we're like a chunk of a rock. And it's like the sculptor was saying. You talk to a sculptor or an artist, and what they will say, they will look at a piece of granite, they will look at a rock, and they say, I can see in that a statue, and that statue is trapped inside. It's trapped inside. And so you ask the sculptor, and what I do, I just keep chiseling away at everything that is marring the image of what's inside. Everything that is veiled of what's on inside, I just keep chipping away at it and chipping away at it so the image that is trapped inside can be saved. You're God's workmanship. God looks at us as a piece of granite, as a large rock, and from the untrained, unskilled eye, we look like a mess. But in the eye of God, we are a masterpiece. A great work and a great value. And so God brings the situations of life, the pressures of life, the temptations of life, the disappointments of life. And those things serve as a chisel in God's hand. And God has his chisel on your life, he has his chisel on my life, and he uses the hammer of adversity to knock on that chisel. And everything he hits up, it appears to be hurting us, but it's going through nothing more than knocking away that which is veiled in what God wants us to be. We're his workmanship. We're his masterpieces. And so when we come forth, once we've gone through the process of allowing God to chisel away all those things that are veiling what we really are, what he really intended for us to be, we then stand forth as his masterpieces, his trophies. Amen. And all eternity will be God's trophy that he put on display. And even the angels themselves are standing in awe. Don't you know the angels right now, angels are in awe of you. They're in awe of you. Because angels, they will not allow to experience the grace of God and salvation. Someone in the promise of God, God didn't provide salvation for angels. For one-third of all the angels who were seduced by Satan and who followed him in his insurrection against the tribunal of God, one-third of those angels excommunicated were kicked out of heaven. And I believe that makes up
shed his blood so that he can offer salvation to us. An angel standing guard, paying all the fact that God would save these creatures that in the original creation they were created lower than the angels. But if God would save them, and then God would give them a song to sing that we can't sing. Don't you know when we get up to glory and we get to the fire together, we will have the angels as our audience. Because they cannot sing, redeemed, redeemed, I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. That is the only song that redeems.
God is holy.
Amen.
God is going to invest in your life and my life. We are his workmanship. Created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk. Don't you know that God has not invested all he's invested in you and me just so we could squander it away, chasing frivolity? Don't you know that God's heart beats and it's throbbing and it aches over the sinful conditions of humanity? Don't you know that offer that you got is a drug? That love that you have is sexually promiscuous? God's heart aches over that person. And God dares that person to experience his love. And then maybe God has placed you in that strategic position so that he can love them through you.
Amen.
As unlovable as they are. God wants to use us. We are his workmanship, creating Christ Jesus unto good works so that his riches of his grace and his mercy can flow through us so that other people can see. Can you see that? God is going to show it all off to the lost. And the way God shows off his riches in time to the unsaved world, he shows off through those who are saved. By working in and through our lives, by transforming our lives, and by giving us hearts of compassion and mercy and love and forgiveness, the Spirit of God falls. And other people can see. There's no reason for this person to care about me. There's got to be a cause. They have to be motivated by something. There has to be a greater motivation than just them wanting to talk about God. And people come to realize that they are loved by God who is loving. And they are loved by God who has all the resources that are needed to restore their life to a place of usefulness, not only to God, but usefulness and utility to themselves, to the family, and to the community. Let us not underestimate God.
Amen.
Let us not underestimate the power of God to change people's lives. I was watching last night, after I was born, they ran a special dealing with 9/11. Mm-hmm. I remember. Got this incredible story. But as an old engineer, I'm listening to what engineers have to say. The guy who designed the building. And of course, his heart was just broken, not because his buildings were demolished, but the fact that people died in a structure that he had designed. And that became their tomb. And he talked about the fact the years of plan and design and the time that it took to construct the Twin Towers. And he says, it took 20 seconds for the phone. 10 seconds each one. He says, in 10 seconds, a lifetime of training, a lifetime of experience was destroyed. And he talked about the sick feeling that gave him the fact that these people died in this building being destroyed. And then another commentator, I think the former governor of New York, Mario Cuomo, he talked about the contrast of what took place on 9/11. I thought this was a beautiful illustration of the gospel. He says that on one hand, you had planes who ran into these buildings to kill people they did not know. People had done them no harm personally. He said, on the other hand, you had the brave firemen and we
scared, would you? What I'm saying is this. The enemy is sending Scud missiles to crash into people's houses, to destroy the family, to destroy the children, to wreak havoc in their lives. And people don't understand why. And that's not a question we ask after 9/11. Why? There's no rational reason for 9/11. Because hatred and bitterness and anger cannot be rationed with. And so people are broken with the question, why? Why did this happen to me? Why did this happen to my child? Why did this happen to my family? And so things are crashing in people's lives. And so God is saying, where are my rescue workers? Where are my rescue workers who are willing to go into people's houses? Go into places to try to save people they don't even know. But the fact that share a common humanity and they share a common need of forgiveness and of salvation. That's what it means to be a Christian. When I come to understand the depth of the depravity of my own soul, when I come to understand that before I came to Jesus Christ, that at my very best, I was a child of disobedience, a child that was a target of God's judgment, walking in sinful passions and desires, manipulated by the spirit of this day. But God made all the difference.
Amen.
And God saved me. And he saved you. Why do we don't think he can save others? And why do we underestimate his power to work through us to bring his mercy, his grace, his love to people who are saved? Don't underestimate what God wants to do in your life. You are a more credible witness to Jesus Christ than what I am. I get paid to do this. So people expect for me to talk about God. And they expect for me to witness. But when you start standing up and talking about it, like you agree, like you're a good friend, close contact, hey, boom, come on, one of your dogs. When you start talking about it like it's real, it gets people's attention. Let's bow together, shall we? Hear me, anybody got to close. Some of you this morning, maybe for the first time, you've heard the Bible description of you. A child of disobedience, a child of wrath, a target of God's judgment, walking in sinful pleasure, controlled by the spirit of the age. But also hope you heard the other part. But God, his rich mercy, his great love, has provided a way for you to escape your past and be marvelously saved by the grace of God. Jesus Christ died for you on the cross. He shed his blood that you might be saved. And he calls you to come to him today. If you're here today, you sense the need to be saved. You desire to be saved. I actually pray right where you are. Just pray this simple prayer. Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that I'm a sinner. I've sinned. I've fallen short of your glory, your standard of righteousness. I believe that you died for me. And that you were buried, that you were raised from the dead. And Lord, I may not understand all that the preacher said, but I want to experience your forgiveness. I want to experience your wealth and forgiveness in my life, your mercy in my life, and right now I receive Jesus Christ by faith as my personal Savior. If you pray your prayer, I want you to take a step of faith. I want you to raise your hand right where you are. God bless you. God bless you. See those hands? God bless you. You prayed your prayer. Raise your hand now by faith to God. You said, Lord, I prayed that prayer. I do want to be saved. I want to make sure my sins are forgiven. Is there another one?
just want to start fresh. We want to start anew.